Welcome, everyone, to the Mr. Mike Podcast, Wrong Answers Only. In this episode, we had the pleasure of interviewing Ann Charles. She is a USA Today bestselling author who writes award-winning stories that are splash of humor, mystery, romance, supernatural, and whatever else sounds like fun. She is a member of the Sisters in Crime and Western Writers of America and has a BA in English with an emphasis on creative writing from the University of Washington. I hope you enjoy this episode. I don't know why. I had one that went 10 years, and then I had that was a great chair, and I got a good price on it. Yeah, and this one's 3 years, and I don't know. I just got up one day, I put my arm on here, and I fell over, and the whole arm broke, and and I'm not looking into investing into a new chair right now until I figure out what's going on with my basement downstairs.
Right. You gotta wait till everything else around it's done.
I've interviewed a couple of people recently, and everyone's name is Anne lately.
It's like the in name at the moment. It's the Heather of the, 1980s, when everybody was Heather, it seemed like?
Well, when I was born, everybody was named Michael, so.
Michael, there you go. So you got that name.
That's how I got my name. And I know my friend got named Michael after Michael Jackson, and that was a common thing back then, right?
Right.
And I don't know, my parents name me Michael because there's a Michael. It's like a tradition in her name. It's either Michael, there's a Dominic. I'm a Michael Dominic. And anyways. Yeah, exactly. So everybody had a version of that name or something growing up. But anyways, all good. Anne Charles, USA Today bestseller author who writes award-winning stories. And you write about humor, mystery, romance, supernatural, all mixed into one. You're a member of the Sisters in Crime and Western Writers of America, and you have a BA in English with an emphasis on creative writing from the University of Washington. And I always do not a preliminary check, not like a background check, but I go and explore everyone that I got to talk to this summer, and I see what they're up to and different things. You went to university and then boom, you're an author, or you went to university and you dabbled in writing while you were working and now you're a best-selling author.
Well, I did the 10-year plan for the 4-year degree, you know?
Yeah.
And I went to, in that 10 years time, I went to 4 different colleges and ended up at University of Washington due to life and work and, you know, everything outside. I would just, wherever I was at, try to get back to finishing that 4-year degree. You know, it started at a small community college in Ohio. Then I was at another community college in Southern California while there. And then I went to Northern Arizona University in Flagstaff, Arizona, and then moved up to Seattle and finished the last couple years at the University of Washington. So, and during that time, it wasn't until I was living in Arizona that I started dabbling in writing. Until then, I was just trying to get a degree, and it changed. At one point, it was Spanish. I thought about pre-law, but then I thought again, I love the idea of archaeology, but at the time it just seemed like it was so much writing, ironically, that I didn't want to write that much. So I was like, I don't know. So I really kind of mixed went all around. And then when I went up to UW, I had to start, because I worked a full-time day job, I had to start nights and going to night school. And the thing they offered, they had like 10 degrees they offered at that time. And one was English. And by that time, one of the things I talk about when I'll do some of the in-person talks I've done is every college I went to did not accept the previous one's English 101, the basic English. It was absurd. What? So I had I don't know. I mean, I had 4 years of high school English. Then I went to college at a community and I had to take another English. And then I moved, like I said, from Ohio to California. And that community college said, well, we think you need to take our English because the Ohio English was different and it won't meet our, you know, whatever curriculum. And then I moved from there to Northern Arizona University, and they said, well, that community college English isn't as good as our university English, so we need you to take it here. And then I moved to UW, and oh my gosh, you have to take the basic English again. So by that point, I was like, I think the universe is trying to tell me that I need to major in English, or I just have really bad English speaking skills or something, because, oh my, I took so many English classes. So, and at that point, I had written so many papers. I joked that, you know, give me a paper clip and tell me to write 2 pages about it, and I can fill the 2 pages, because I'd had so many English classes. I just, with that night, you know, classes, that's what I could take. And then eventually the last year I was able to work part-time and finish college. And so I added the creative writing part to get some of those classes, because I had started writing by then, fiction. And it wasn't because I always wanted to be a fiction writer. It was, I had read some books and I liked the books, but I didn't love the endings. And I was kind of disgruntled. And I said to myself, listen, if you don't like the endings, maybe you should write your own books and write the endings you want. And then shut up about it. I mean, the left side of my brain is really mean to the right side of my brain, I think. It's like, so do something about it. So I started writing, and, you know, it took me many books. It wasn't till, I believe it was the 7th or 8th book that I published, was the first one published that I had written. So I didn't instantly just go, oh, look, I can write. It was years of trial and error. And, you know, sometimes thinking, I don't know why I thought I could do this. This is really hard. But eventually, that's how it all worked out. And then I started publishing in 2011.
In terms of the editing process to go into your books, did you have third party edit your books? Did you have a network of or community of people that helped you out? Did you bounce ideas off them? How did that process work out for you?
I really have both. I write chapter by chapter. You know, I'll plot out a book loosely because I never stick to the plot. So that I've planned, but I start with something to let me know, yeah, I can handle this. And then as I write chapter by chapter, I'll write the first and then I'll polish it and get it to what I want. And then I'll send it off to what I have a group called my first draft crew. And there's about 12 of them. And most of them have been there since the beginning. And they're really good at helping me with that first draft without shutting me down, you know, without such criticism that I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't do this. This is horrible. They've never been like that, but yet they give me great feedback. Each has their own purpose in many ways for me. Some are more grammatical, you know, and others are looking at concepts. So we go through that. And then I put all those in and I go through it all again when it's done. And then I send it off to a professional editor and she goes through the whole thing. And then I have a crew, beta crew of anywhere. It'll run anywhere from 25 to 45 people, depending how many I choose. And these guys have been fine too, you know, have over time I've picked and choosed because they each bring different things to the table as well. And so then we'll go through beta and then I'll get it back, put in any edits needed. And then my editor will go through it one more time for me and then she'll get it back. And then I go through it along with a woman who helps me. She has a business called Your Storyteller and she works with me to make sure because I have multiple series and they're long series with plots that keep going, she'll make sure everything's correct along with me. And then we publish it.
That's a due process. You got a lot of people behind you.
It is. By the time the books go live, at least, I would say at least 60 people have looked at this. And, you know, errors will still get through. It's incredible. Yeah. The smallest error will still make it through. And it takes about, from the time I finish the manuscript, it takes a month to go through the process and formatting and release the books. So I wish I could go faster. You know, because really when you're done with that first draft, you know, you just feel like, I'm done. I want to move on to the next. But it's a whole nother, you know, cycle of editing to make it polished.
How long does it take you to get a manuscript together?
Well, I write these books. I wish I wrote shorter books just because I could move quicker in this process and have more books go out to everybody. But I write typically about 125,000 word books. So they're longer manuscripts. And that can take me, most of the time, if I'm doing really well, it can take me 4 months. If life is kicking me around, it can take 6 months or more. So, but I, you know, in the good times, I write, when I'm in the thick of it, I'll try to write 2,000 words a day. And sometimes that means 3,000 to 4,000. And sometimes I'm creeping, you know, the last 100 words is just gibberish so that I can hit it and shut down for the day because I'm tired. So it just takes me a little bit longer to get books out because they're longer.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. What series was your first series?
Well, the actual, because I had like 7 books that I didn't publish. I mean, I had the Dig Site series was written first. After that, I wrote some of the Jackrabbit series. But again, those were I rewrote the first dig site book probably four times till I got it, because I'd you know, the first draft was way back when, and then my critique group absolutely hated the hero in that. It was like the second book I wrote, and they said, you can never use this name again for any character. We hate this hero so much. And I was like, it was a romance. You're not supposed to hate the hero like that. So, you know, I put that aside and I would try the next book, and I kept going back and forth. The first book I published was Nearly Departed in Deadwood, the first book in the Deadwood mystery series. And that was in early 2011. And like I said, I believe that's the eighth book. I'd have to go back and count and think it out. But it wasn't until that book that, you know, I cleaned it up. It went through processes. It went through a big publisher who almost purchased it. The editorial team signed off, but marketing didn't. So that was the one that really went out first, you know, and then I wrote the second of that had already been written. So that went second. And then I went back to a Jackrabbit series and pulled the first one of that and put that out. So kind of came third series I started came out first, but then we went backwards and added the others back in.
I'm on your website right now. I always like to peruse while everybody's talking so I can like see what they've done, and I'm reading bits of it. You also have ebooks, print versions, and audio versions of your books.
We do, yeah. Everything's the most recent release, Jackrabbit Junction number 6, Twisty Tortoise Tussles. She is in the process right now of narrating. Lisa Larson is narrating that for me, and that will come out in September. She'll finish up and we'll put that out. But yes, everything is out there in audio. And that was a decision way back in like 2012, 2013. I mean my husband and myself together. And we decided, yeah, let's invest some money in audio. It really wasn't popular yet at all, but had the opportunity, met with a company that kind of is a middle company between the artist and Blackstone, who has grown since we started way back then, and got started with Deadwood number 1, and we've just continued to add since that.
They're popular, the audio versions of the book?
They are now. It, you know, 4 years ago, people were buying them, but not, it's still, ebooks still ruled when it came to it. But in the last few years, yeah, audiobooks have just, the market's really gotten hot. So I'm really glad we made that decision we did way back when, because there's over, I think the next book we publish will be 34 published books, and the cost to put out an audiobook is big. Wow. So it's not, you know, like an ebook where you can do it, of course, at home. I know there's the new narrator, automatic narrator now that people can use, digitally narrated. And I don't even know how that, you know, if it's good or not. I haven't listened to anything, but I do like to have actual people reading, especially having humor. If you don't land that line correctly, it's flat. You know, you have to have the emphasis a lot of time on like, what the heck are you talking about? Versus, what the heck are you talking about?
Right.
You know, it's a huge difference. So having humor, I really like having the actors narrating for, you know, the stories. But yeah, they're popular, and I love it. I love listening to them. So it's good. Others are enjoying them too.
Well, it's a good thing that you love listening to your own books, right?
Yeah, exactly. Because I have to listen to them a lot of times before I start. Because all of my series are ongoing. They're not individual books, you know, that like an Agatha Christie mystery or Nancy Drew. These are, the plots are, you know, ongoing. And so I have to go back and reread several of the books to get my head totally back in and remember all the little nuggets I've left for future, you know, mysteries. And that takes some time. I mean, Deadwood mystery series, I'm getting ready to start number 13 in the fall. That means I got about a month of prepping mentally, you know, reading, listening. So I'll listen when I'm out walking around, you know, walking the neighborhood or whatever. Boy, that sounds good. Walking the neighborhood, not on the corners, walking around the neighborhood. But anyway, I'll do that and just try to catch up and get back into the story so I can jump into that other series.
Oh, it's an incredible amount of work that goes into it. And now that you're so far along to research your own writing, because you've written so much, it's really in depth. Do you have like a war room where you have notes all over the bulletin boards and to keep track of what's going on?
So that lady, her name's Diane. I talked about her and your storyteller, her business. She has an extensive OneNote, Microsoft OneNote file that she keeps for each of my series.
Okay.
And so I can go back, and when I say extensive, I mean amazingly extensive. So that's the equivalent of that. I can go in and say, let's punch on this character, and she'll have all the notes on everything from eye color, typical colognes, what vehicle they drive, nicknames used, mm-hmm. to each, you know, different parts of the story. Same with buildings, same with supernatural characters. It goes on and on. The list of details that have to be kept in an ongoing series in order to keep the readers from feeling pulled out of the story because, oh, you changed that. That's not right. It's amazing. And believe me, readers are so smart when they listen, especially binge. I mean, I do it too. You notice all the little details. And if something gets changed, it's just like, wait, time out. You know, you screwed this up, author, and it pulls you right out of that world. And that's the last thing, you know, we want with these series.
Consistency.
Yes.
It needs exactly. to be consistent. So everyone buys in and stays immersed in the story, and especially over the long haul, right?
Exactly. I mean, the Deadwood series, like I said, 2011 was the first one. So it's been 11 years. And so there is a lot of information in all those books that we have to keep, you know, and keep track of. And my readers know that if I mention something in particular, like say in book 8, but I don't maybe mention it in book 9, it's coming back. You know, they know that they've already gotten how I work with. There's a little seed planted and we're going to come back to that.
And that's great that you bring them back. You keep them, you don't just kind of throw them useless pieces of information. You're like, this is here for a reason. It might be the next book, or it might be in a couple of books later, but keep it in mind. And then, like you said, exactly. readers are intelligent and they remember everything. And I think it helps grows the series, right?
I think it makes it more fun. I'm a big binge watcher of series on different, you know, TV, Netflix, whatever, all the different series channels, but our shows. And I remember those details. And so, yeah, for those who started with me way back then, a lot of times they'll reread part of the series over and over again, and they'll wait, you know, a year for a book. But if you come in brand new and you read, and I have that where people write me, for the last few weeks, all I've been reading is your books. And I feel like, wow, you're in a whole nother world right now coming out. You know, it's like detox coming out of that when you come out of a story world like that, which is wonder. It's a fun thing, you know, where you get so immersed, but they'll notice all kinds of things. It's incredible.
Hey, friends, check out the new podcast by Defining Moments Canada. We need to talk about Bryce, Courageous Conversations with Bobby Henry and Guests. This podcast was created as part of Defining Moments Canada's national commemoration of Dr. Peter Bryce's 1922 pamphlet, The Story of a National Crime, in which he uses his platform as a chief medical officer of the Department of Indian Affairs to call out appalling health conditions in residential schools. Each episode features an excerpt of the 1922 report, which is then discussed by host Bobby Henry and his guests. Bobby Henry is an assistant professor in Brock University's Faculty of Education and a PhD student in Indigenous Studies. He is of the Bald Deer Clan and a member of the Cayuga Nation, a nation of the Six Nations of the Haudenosaunee Confederation. His guests on the podcast are expert in the fields of Indigenous health, education, and advocacy. Each episode also features a teacher-created listening guide to help teachers and students bring this resource into their classroom. Listen on Spotify, Apple Music, YouTube, or on Defining Moments Canada's website. And you mentioning about your Deadwood Undertaker series. The last book, number 4, came out in September 2022, right?
It's coming out. Yeah,
that's coming out.
Yeah, that's what we're working on right now. My husband, Sam Lucky, and I are working on, the backside of Hades. So yeah, we're in the thick of getting this thing almost, we're getting it through the first draft crew and getting ready to go to editor within the next few weeks, hopefully, if all goes as planned.
And then you have a couple more books lined up. Dig Site Mystery, Summer 2023, and book number 13 of the Deadwood Mystery Series in early 2023. So you have a couple more lined up.
Yeah, it's like planes on a runway. And that Dig Site number 3, I've been trying to move that plane up to fly for a good year, but it has two in the series, and it's a building series. And, you know, with Deadwood, the main Deadwood one that I'm going to be working on next after the Backside of Hades, the following on that is so big that if I go more than a year, which I have now because of the other books I've done, the fans are like, come on, where's, you know, the next Deadwood book. And so that one in particular, I really have to kind of make sure I hit once a year, which might bump a different one out. And the Jackrabbit series number 6 just came out at the end of July, early August. And that one now has the following. After you hit book 5, you build and build and build, it seems. Book 5 currently is kind of the tipping point where once you have that 5th book out in a series, people are going, okay, now there's 5 books. Now I'll invest my time in it because there's enough meat to keep me going for a while in this story world. It seemed like way back when, it used to be 3 books. And you had, you know, that. But I think with all the different series on television and you know, the 8 and 10 show series episodes that they do for different shows, I think it's you know, expanded that a little bit in the book world too for people. You really got to want to commit, you know.
I think people want more of the same instead of jumping from show to show or book to book. They're like, this is really great. Why can't we have 8 or 10 10 books of it, or right. 10 series of it, right?
Right. And my books are character driven. So it's not, the mystery is there, the adventure or suspense, whatever I'm doing, you know, there is a story question with each book that I answer, but really it's an ongoing series. So the character, it's all character driven. So that means it's not as much about the mystery and solving that as about how the characters are dealing with things and handling things and living their lives around the mystery. And that's where the humor comes in, because of all these crazy characters and lives. And nobody's life is perfect. And as the author, you know, the diabolical author, I get to get in there and go, oh, let's mix this up and make this a pain for you, you know? So yeah. It's about how they keep going in spite of the walls they hit, you know, and I think it's encouraging for people that just keep going, keep trying to find a way around this problem.
Yeah. In terms of your other books, The Old Man's Back in Town, that's not part of any series. That's a separate book on its own.
Well, it's a series I want to write and have wanted to write for years. It's the Nevada group that's in my mind. And that is a short story from that. And I wrote it years ago for, I believe, an anthology. I was with other authors and something fresh was needed. So I wrote this story and I want to incorporate it. And you'll find hints of it, especially in the Deadwood Mystery series. Well, we'll talk about the town down there in Nevada because I'm building to that. And I hope, you know, to have that as a future series, but I currently have 5 that are ongoing and that maxes me out. Like I said, if I wrote shorter books, I could probably jump quicker and do, you know, a little bit more for each, but I'm at my limit at this point. And so, and the popularity of the big ones, I can't stop them because they're doing so well and everybody loves them. So I keep that as my main focus. And I think I've got a lot of years yet till I can retire. So that's kind of out in the future. I have some wonderful older friends that I've known for years that are now retiring. And I've known them since my 20s when I started writing with them. You know, they write different books. And I often think, yeah, we're about ready to retire. And I go, oh, wait, I've got like 20, 25 years yet before that. So never mind.
Yeah, sure. I know the feeling. got a ways to go, but yeah. That's amazing that you got so much depth to your so much in your repertoire that people can choose this series, this series, and you got a lot of ideas, and it's time, it's energy. I mean, the process, like you said, going through the manuscripts and editing and finishing and getting the team to go back and forth. And what about the book cover designs? Like, who helps you with that?
So my brother C.S. Kunkel is an artist, and he, since we were kids, I mean, he's 4.5 years older than me. So I always would sit next to him as he drew and monsters and stuff, and, you know, drive him nuts like a younger sister will when you're a kid. But he's always, you know, worked for years, back in his, I think his late 20s, he was doing drawings for Grateful Dead magazine. He had stuff accepted there. Anyway, so when I was trying to go through the big publisher route and hit walls and then got, you know, had the rejection from that marketing team and decided, hey, you know, indie or independent publishing through Amazon, ebooks and print, it's becoming a thing. Maybe form a small press and try that route. And he said, you know, I'd like to try my hand at some graphics or illustrations for your covers and maybe in your books if you're open to it. And I said, of course, because stock art only goes so far. Everybody can access it. And it's really hard to have original covers. And I knew if he did the art, I would have original covers right out of the gate. And it would brand my book similar. So you would look at it, you know, and see this art style that, you know, kind of you look at after a while and go, that looks like an Ann Charles without even seeing the name. And so I was very, you know, interested in him doing it. And so he submitted three for the first cover for Nearly Departed. He did three different drawing concepts and we kind of talked about it, but then he goes on his, you know, you kind of talk about stuff with him and then let his artist brain go forth, which is awesome. And he came up with three different covers and I loved all three. One had this creepy clown cookie jar, which kind of goes with an element of the first story, and it like a creepy skeleton hand coming out and holding a Calamity Jane Realty brochure, because that's the heroine, she works for that company anyway. And I loved it, but I knew just talking and showing it to a few people hate clowns. Yes. And that was back before the It movie, the recent one, you know, that had everybody, but oh man, people don't like clowns, and it'll just shut them down right out of the gate. So I was like, well, we can't use the clown. And then another had a skeleton in a casket. It was Wild Bill Hickok's casket with a violet flower on it, because the heroine's name's Violet. And I really like that too. But the one with the legs that we chose, I thought pulled a lot more, you know, and as I asked around friends and family, they tended to be more interested in picking up a story with that cover. So that's how it started. He does the drawings and does sometimes it's in pieces, sometimes it's one whole drawing. And then I have graphic artists. For years, I've had a couple different, but for the last about 5 years, I think my husband, Sam Lucky's been the graphic artist. So he takes them, scans them, and then puts it all together, does a lot of time with them too. And as a group, the three of us, we put out these covers, which I love.
More time, more energy. Like the process, again, the process is so deep and it takes more than one person to really get it going. But that's great that you guys can, all three of you can get together and be creative and put that out. So I love the covers. Yeah. The covers are fantastic.
Well, what's fun too is each book that has, you know, my brother does illustrations then about six or seven inside each book. So we go through and that's something his wife does, is she reads the books chapter, she's in the first draft crew, and she will help me pick out illustrations that we both, you know, that he might like drawing that will spur that creativity. So yeah, it's also kind of fun to have the different illustrations that, you know, are inside both the ebook and the printed book.
That's really cool. I mean, there's so much depth to what you're telling me.
It's a whole busy business. It's not. I always joke with other authors that I know put a lot of work into it, that, oh, you know, the dream life as a writer. And, you know, we look at the crow's feet around our eyes and all that from the lack of sleep. And it's like, yes, dream, the entrepreneur dream. Woohoo. Yeah. But it is great. I mean, once you've built it and you get the machine going and everything's spinning, then it just takes a little bit here and there. And I do have a huge group of people that work with us and help us, a lot of family. We have wonderful family, both my husband's side and mine, that do so many things that are part of the business too. So it's a real family effort in many ways.
Like a family business.
Yeah.
That's great. And talking about business, let's get to the business aspect of it, because you're literally everywhere on social media. So we'll plug your social medias, but your website, annecharles.com, you have all your books on your website. There's also autographed copies that people can buy if they're interested in, correct?
Right. Yeah. I have a store out of my, and we have stock here. So we sell them right out of the house, and I autograph with whatever you want in them, you know, and throw in some extra fun promo little gifts with it.
That's cool. And in terms of, because I can see it streaming across the off the top, Barnes & Noble, top 100 bestseller author, USA Today, bestselling author. You've had some interesting credentials to go with your books now.
I've been really fortunate, because the readers, they're not just avid readers. They're wonderful groups of, I mean, we're a team. We really are. We go forth with each release as a team, you know, and without them, I'd fall flat. But yeah, it's been, so far, it's been an amazing, amazing ride. I had a question on Jeopardy. Alex Trebek, you know, something about Anne Charles writes books in this morbid sounding town, set in this morbid sounding town. I didn't know that was going to happen. That was a huge surprise. And that happened years ago. And then it'll do on the repeat, you know, they'll replay it on television. I'll get people that email me, hey, you were just on Jeopardy. So it's really been a wild, exciting ride. And I look forward to, you know, whatever comes next as we keep going.
You're part of pop culture. There you go.
Yeah.
That's awesome. And in terms of that, AnneCharles.com. You're also on Facebook, Anne Charles author page. You're on TikTok, Anne Charles Books, Twitter, and W Charles, Instagram, and Charles, well, and underscore Charles, and Snapchat, Pinterest, BookPub, Goodreads. Your books are available on Amazon, all the books, or select
Amazon, your, all the big guys, Kobo, Apple, all the big guys. Yeah.
And all your books are available, or most of them are available in ebook form, audio form,
and print. Yeah.
And print form. So that's like, you have reach. Reach anybody. If there's something they want to listen, they want to read, they want to get it here. That's fantastic.
Yep. Doing the best we can to distribute as wide as we can, you know, as a small business. Thankfully, there's all these channels that you can, you know, help get your book further out there to different countries, different places. So yeah, it's, we're doing the best we can to, you know, find more places to put the books out there. So it's easier to get to them.
And in terms of anything else going forward, have I missed a social media plug or?
I don't think so. I think, and I'm not all on there all the time, or I'd never do anything else, but yeah. I do try to check in if somebody messages me within a week, I try to get back. You know, I do get email from people that I write back to them. Again, sometimes it's right away. Sometimes it takes me weeks. It just depends where I'm at in the process of everything else going on. Plus life. I have two teenagers. I have some aging parents that we're working, helping out more and more. So it's we're in those sandwich years where we're, you know, everything's coming from both ends. So it's a little crazy at our house sometimes, but I'm here.
More work and less sleep.
Exactly. More caffeine, more twitchy eyes. Whatever it takes.
I always give everybody the last word. If they want to make a plug on one of their books or future books coming up, or if they want to entice everybody to get, let's give them something. What do you want to plug?
Let me just end with, and it's something I often tell people is the reason I write is not to change your life and make you want to get rid of all your books and furniture and clean your house out and, you know, live like that or anything like that. I write these stories to entertain, to give you an escape from your reality. Maybe you don't need, you know, maybe your reality is all roses and everything's wonderful, but mine's not. Mine has a lot of stuff where I just need to escape into some story world for a while, relax, you know, find my happy place, then come back and face whatever I'm having to deal with life. And that's what these are for. There's humor. That's one of my main elements in all the stories, because I find that humor is what I use to deal with, you know, stress and problems and keep me going. So that's what these are. Just go and have fun. And hopefully you share a sense of humor with me and get some laughs.
Everybody needs a sense of humor. That's what, yes. I thought. I live on sarcasm. So without it, I can't get through my day.
I'm with you. Yes.
I really appreciate you coming on the podcast. You know, if there's anything you want to share with me going forward between now and forever, feel free. I will share it with everybody. I primarily will share on Twitter, but as the year comes closer, I'm going to start posting some stuff on Instagram for episodes. But feel free to tag me on Twitter and Instagram, or email me if you have anything, and I will share it with everyone.
Great. Thank you so much. Thanks for having me on here. It's been great chatting with you.
Yeah, you're awesome. Thank you very much for coming on. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in to the Mr. Mike Podcast, Wrong Answers Only. We're going to continue bringing you exceptional interviews with awesome guests. Don't forget to follow us on social media, Mr. Mike MTL, Wrong Answers MTL on Twitter, Wrong Answers MTL on Instagram. Check out our website, www.mrmikemtl.com, for all podcast episodes, past, present, blog posts. We also have an affiliate partnership with WriteMe.ai. Check out our Twitch link, which is on our webpage. We'll be doing Twitch streaming in the future. Also, we have a merchandise shop provided by The Fourth Ball that is on our website as well. So feel free to check out some of our merchandise with Mr. Mike logos, some apparel, some mugs. Again, your donations and support are appreciated. If you'd like to be a guest on the show, we have 2 waiting lists. Go to the website, fill out a guest profile. If you have any questions, use the contact form or message us on social media. Don't forget, share, download, like, retweet. Tell your friends and family. Tell the people on the street. Tell the people at the grocery stores, at the gym, at work. Thank you, friends, for tuning in. And we'll see you next time.